This week, as I threatened, we're going to have the everything explained, and we're going to begin with the vestments, and then every element of the Mass explained. Now, I apologize in advance. This isn't the best liturgical form to have all this jabbering during our prayer, but if I only do it one time and one time only, for instructional purposes only, and I never inflict it on you again, I feel like I can get away with it. The first thing is the vestment. This is an alb. It's called that because it's white. The Latin word for white is alba. So this is an alb. I once had somebody say, well, our servers are going to wear red. Well, then it wouldn't be an alb, would it? Because albs have to be white, symbolizing the purity of the prayer. Not the purity of the priest, although we can hope, but a purity of the prayer. We also use the word albumen, egg white. So, I guess if we had a red alb, it would be a roja. But instead, no, this is an alb. The next vestment's the most important for the priest. It's the stole. In ancient Rome, when you captured people and brought them to Rome to be sold as slaves, you held up an ox yoke in this shape. They had to pass underneath the ox yoke. When they got to the other side, they were property of Rome and they could be auctioned off as slaves. This is a symbol that I'm supposed to work for you free of charge. I'm not supposed to charge you if I got to go to the hospital or come to the home visit. It's to be free of charge, free service to the people. Very important. And the last vestment, which is the most interesting, I think, when the Catholic Church got the freedom to be legally constituted in Rome, the Emperor Constantine gave us the Edict of Toleration, I think in the year 325. And they all came to him and said, well, that's fine that we're now allowed to celebrate our faith in public, but we have no churches. We've been celebrating the Mass in the cemetery or in barns, and we need some place to celebrate the Mass. And Constantine said, well, there are 8 old abandoned courthouses that are no longer used. So I'm going to give those 8 courthouses to the church as your first churches. They're called basilicas, a courthouse. Today, if a particular church has special reverence, they can be named a basilica. Then the bishop said, well, what do we wear in there? Up to now, we've just worn the same clothes as everybody else. And he said, well, I don't know. Wear what you want. He said, well, we'll wear what the judge wore. This is the judge's robe from a basilica. And it doesn't mean that the priest is your judge. It's a celebration of our freedom to celebrate our faith. And so we're still wearing this ancient Roman judge's robe. Next time you go to traffic court, make sure that the judge has their chasuble on. That black outfit they're wearing, yeah, it comes from ancient Rome. So now we got everything together, and we're about to begin Mass with the entrance chant. You pick up the Roman Missal, it said the opening song is the entrance chant, where you welcome the ministers in. In the old days, we used to call it the processional. Then we got used to calling it the gathering song. I don't know why, because I can't find that in any document, any place at all, ever. But we just got used to it. And then when I hear the gathering song, it makes me feel like we're all out gathering daisies and dandelions, and they got to gather us all in. So I don't know. We're going to stand and sing the entrance chant. So I'll go back there so we can get this underway.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Margaret of Scotland Church. Our Mass intention for this Mass is for the repose of the soul of Fred Kaysen by Jean and Denise Gallo. Please take a moment to silence all cell phones. A few announcements. Please drop off your items for the Gabriel Project by this Wednesday, August 3rd. A list of requested items can be found in this week's bulletin.
Here this week.
Save the date for our annual parish picnic. It will be on Sunday, August 28th. Please join us next Sunday, August 7th, immediately following the 10 a.m. Mass, for an appreciation celebration as we wish Kathy LaCar much joy and happiness in her retirement and thank her for her many years of loving service to our parish family. See more parish news in the bulletin. Let us take a few moments of prayerful silence before we begin. Please stand and take a moment to wave to everyone around you. Our opening song is number 704, God Whose Purpose Is to Kindle, number 704.
Everything we do now is a restoration of something from an earlier period or that had just sort of fallen kind of in secondary use, except for one thing. Pope Paul decided that the Mass should begin with the sign of the cross. That's the one brand new element that we added to the Mass. Remember, all you guys who were altar boys would come in, the altar boys would kneel down, and the priest would begin the Mass, Introibil ad altari Dei. I go to the altar of God. And the little boys would say, Adeum quile tipicat juventutum meum, or some variety, if they could pronounce it. And that meant, the God who gives joy to my youth. Well, we scrapped that. And Pope Paul said, begin the Mass in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The only brand new element to the Mass. And before we join together in prayer, we first of all remember our sins. Not because we're eaten up by guilt, but it's a recognition that God calls us here because he loves us. Not because we're good and deserve it. He's calling us here because he loves us. And so we recognize his love by first of all calling to mind that we're sinners and asking for forgiveness. Let's take a moment to remember our sin. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. The next prayer is not a second penitential rite. It's the Kyrie, the only prayer of the Mass that used to be in Greek, a symbol that this is the universal church, the Catholic Church, East and West, Greek and Latin, and it's a prayer, the only prayer of the Mass, directed to Jesus. Every other prayer is directed to God the Father about Jesus. This prayer is a prayer of praise to Jesus. If you ever fly to Greece and the airline, you'll hear him get on the thing before you land and go, Kakirie, Kakiria. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mr., the Lord, Since you, Jesus, are the Lord, you alone have the right to have mercy. Since you, Christ, are the Christ, you alone have the right to have mercy. It's a prayer of praise, not a second penitential rite. So we say, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. Some of these opening prayers are 1,500 years old. It's called the Collect, and it gives us the theme of this Mass. Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer their prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as their creator and guide, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. And we now are seated to listen to the scripture reading.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Vanity of vanities, says Kohelet. Vanity of vanities. All things are vanity. Here is one who has labored with the wisdom and knowledge and skill, and yet to another who has not labored over it, he must leave his property. This is also vanity and a great misfortune. For what profit comes to man from all the toil and anxiety of heart with which he has labored under the sun? All his days, sorrow and grief are their occupation. Even at night, his mind is not at rest. This is also vanity. The word of the Lord.
Yeah. reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, if you were raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Think of what is above, not what is on earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, your life, appears, then you too will appear with him in glory. Put to death, then, the parts of you that are earthly: immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and the greed that is idolatry. Stop lying to one another, since you have taken off the old self with its practices and put on the new self, which is being renewed for knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcision and uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. And this is the word of the Lord.
Claimed anything from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we stand out of respect for Jesus, because it's in those gospels that we most clearly find him. Think of the gospel as a place we go to encounter the Lord Jesus. And to symbolize how holy that is, we introduce the gospel with an alleluia, the only time we use a Hebrew word in Mass. Alleluia is Hebrew for praise the Lord. And so we stand because of the gospel, and we sing the alleluia verse. Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to share the inheritance with me." He replied to him, "Friend, who appointed me as your judge and arbiter?" Then he said to the crowd, "Take care to guard against all greed. For though one may be rich, one's life does not consist of possessions." Then he told them a parable. There was a rich man whose land produced a bountiful harvest. He asked himself, "What shall I do? For I do not have the space to store my harvest." And he said to him, "This is what I shall do. I shall tear down my barns and build larger ones. There I shall store all my grain and other goods, and I shall say to myself, 'Now as for you, you have so many good things stored up for so many years. Rest, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this night your life will be demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, to whom will they belong?' Thus it will be for all those who store up treasure for themselves and are not rich in what matters to God." The Gospel of the Lord. As you pick up your bulletin, you'll have an insert, a part of the first apology of Justin Martyr. This was composed about the year 138, extremely early. Justin also is a very special man. He's the first layman to be a universally recognized saint of the church outside of the Bible. He was a great philosopher, brilliant man, but he was a pagan. And he lived in Nablus. And in Nablus, right after the fall of the temple, all of the Jewish rabbis gathered, reformed the Sanhedrin, and they said, we got to make sure that Judaism survives. The temple's gone. We have all these synagogues, but there's not a standard synagogue religious service. And so all 20,000 rabbis began debating what the synagogue service would be like and what some other things were like. And they came up with the service that now is the present service in every synagogue in the world. But they had to hammer that out. Well, Justin Martyr, the pagan, was watching all that. And in the same town of Nablus were this other group, brand new group, Christians. And they had the same problem the Jews had. How do we form a worship service that's going to be uniform everywhere? And they put together the Mass. Now, we don't even know what the word Mass means. It's lost in history. The bread of the poor, which is the only bread allowed at Mass, was called the Misa. That might be it, the breaking of the Misa. We don't know. It could be the dismissal. Go, the Mass is ended. Ita Misa est. No. Maybe it's the Misa. We don't know. It's just lost to history. We know what it is in Greek, the Thanksgiving. Eucharistes, Thanksgiving. Thank you, God the Father, for sending us Jesus. That's what the whole Mass is for that. But he watched the Mass fall into place. And as a pagan, he copied everything down. He eventually was converted to Christianity. Became a Christian. And now we have his first apology of the whole Christian religion and two different accounts of what Mass looked like. You take this home and read it from 138. It's incredible. Think about that, 138. I'll be 75 years old Tuesday. Now, I'm not telling you that because I'd like a present. Although, no, we're not going to go there. But I'll be 75. Imagine if I'm standing in front of Justin Martyr as he's writing this in 138 and saying, Justin, when I was born 75 years ago, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John had not yet been written. Or the book of Revelation. Or the Acts of the Apostles. The letters of Paul, but they weren't collected in one spot. You know, he was present at the foundational moment of Christianity. And as a pagan, he didn't have a dog in that fight. He just wrote down what he saw. Later became a Christian. So we have an account of the Mass here. The Mass, he saw people praying prior to the year 138. So take that home and read it over. I think you'll recognize the Mass in it completely. He made one big mistake. I guess it's because he became Catholic. You know, Catholics, if they don't know, they make something up. And so he says, they all gather on Sunday because it's the first day of the week. It's the day that God changed darkness and matter into light. It's the day Christ rose from the dead. Oh, none of that's true. But he didn't know. He's Catholic now, so he makes it up. Why do we meet on Sunday? Simplest reason in the world. All the first Christians were Jews. And on the Jewish day of rest, the Sabbath, Saturday, they were all busy, even as Christians, doing the Jewish stuff. They had the Sabbath meal and the Sabbath ceremonies. When that was all over, then they could do the Christian stuff. The next day, Sunday. So we still gather on Sunday because the first Christians were Jews and they were too busy on the Sabbath doing Jewish stuff. That's really the truth. That's why we gather on Sunday as our Sabbath, the Sunday Sabbath. Now, what is a homily? In Justin Martyr, it says, after the The readers read the readings and the memoirs of the apostles, the gospels. Then the president of the assembly, the word is episcopus, from which we get our word bishop, the president then appeals for the imitation of these good things, a homily. What's a homily? Only three things can be preached as a homily. I can preach about the readings of the day. I'm not doing that now. Or I can preach about the feast day. I'm not doing that now. Or I can preach about a part of the Mass. I'm doing that now. I'm preaching about the homily. So this is a homily, because I'm telling you about the homily. It has to be one of those three things. If it's not one of those three things, it's just a religious speech, just a sermon, and they're worthless. If I preach a homily, the church tells me, God will use it to perform miracles in the people. It doesn't have to be a good homily, just a real one. If I do what the church says and preach about the readings, the feast day, or a part of the Mass, then God will use that stuff to convert people, or touch people, to do things in people's lives. If I do something else, it's unworthy of me. So kind of pay attention when you hear preaching. Is the priest talking about one of those three things? If he is, or the deacon, then it's a real homily, and God will use it however God wants to. That's about all for the homily. Justin Martyr never knew about the creed. The creed came after the Council of Nicaea in 325, and he had long been dead after that, prior to that. But now we stand and we recite the creed. The creed was written in Nicaea and Constantinople, and it defines who Jesus is. Jesus is truly divine. He truly is God. So is the Holy Spirit. And so when we stand and proclaim the creed of Nicaea, Constantinople, we're proclaiming who Christ is in our lives. So let's stand now, and together we say, I believe one Son of God, for all ages, God from God, light from light, from true God, made consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. Death and was buried, and on the third day, in accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit.
Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who the Father and the Son has adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and
apostolic church. I confess one baptism
for the forgiveness of sins.
I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
St. Justin writes in the year 138, after the preaching, then they all stand and offer prayers of petition. We're still doing that.
For the church and her leaders, that they may effectively proclaim the true and lasting riches found for all people in Jesus Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our country and for wisdom and inspiration for those who lead us, that God will give them insight into the true issues and the changes that are needed to promote the welfare of everyone, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For families that are divided by inheritance and financial issues, that God will help them recognize the value and dignity of each other and guide them to a resolution of their conflicts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the unemployed and underemployed, for all those whose lives have been affected by storms and natural disasters, and for those who are experiencing discrimination and violence in their lives. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, that they may be healed according to God's will, and that all who have died may be welcomed to the banquet of eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention for which this Mass is being offered, for the repose of the soul of Fred Casson, our prayer chain requests, the prayers in our hearts, and those found in our parish book of intentions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we bring these prayers to you, and we ask you to hear and answer all of them. In the name of Jesus, your Son and our Lord, amen. In a moment, we'll have the bread, wine, and water presented by the people. It was always done in ancient days. And at the end of the service, then the end of the Mass, they would take up a collection. Nowadays, we put the two things together. We're Catholic, after all. They're all gathered around the table, and the father of the family will pick up a piece of bread and say the grace before meals. We're about to share this sacred meal, so we still say the Jewish grace before meals. These are the exact words of an Orthodox family's Jewish grace. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. And we Catholics put in a drop of water in the wine to symbolize us. Wine costs something. It's precious. It's valuable. Water falls out of the sky free. We're very ordinary. We're not nearly as important as the wine, but we symbolize that we're entering into the divine life of God through this drop of water. By the mystery of this mingling of water and wine, may we come to share in your divinity as you humble yourself to share in our humanity. And then the father of the family will pick up a glass of wine at the table and say the second half of the Jewish grace before meals. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands that will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. For 1,000 years during the collection, they didn't give money. Nobody had money. So they gave the priest a dead chicken to eat that week, or a few onions, maybe a turnip. And at the end of the collection, his hands were filthy, and he had to wash them. Nowadays, you're giving me clean money, but we're still washing from the filthy collection. Lord, wash away my iniquity and cleanse me of my sins. See, he didn't think I had. Pray, brothers and sisters, that your sacrifice and mine will be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. Graciously sanctify these gifts, O Lord, we pray, and accepting the oblation of this spiritual sacrifice, make us an eternal offering to you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the preface gives us the theme of this Eucharistic prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You form man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you had made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so, with all the angels we praise you, and in joyful celebration we acclaim. Pay attention to the number of times that each paragraph is directed to God the Father about Jesus. The first paragraph is the epiclesis, the calling down from heaven of the Holy Spirit to change these gifts of bread and wine into Jesus. For the Orthodox and the Byzantine Catholics, this is the moment of consecration. They have the right to say that. For us, it's the words of institution, but we still have the epiclesis. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have the institution narrative, the story of the Last Supper, through which this bread and wine become the living body and blood of our Lord Jesus. At the time he was betrayed, and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." And it says the priest will genuflect in adoration. To genuflect in adoration means worship. If this isn't God, that would be idolatry, but it is God. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and the eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." And once again, the rubric says the priest will genuflect in adoration. Christ is present, body, blood, soul, and divinity in both forms. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again, until you come again.
Jesus said, "Do this in memory of him." The next paragraph tells us what we're remembering. It's the anamnesis. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. And we pray for all the living. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, James our Bishop, and all the clergy. And we pray for all the dead. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles James and John, and with all the saints, especially Margaret of Scotland, who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. To end the Eucharistic prayer, we have the doxology. After that, you pray the most important prayer of the people during the whole Mass, the great Amen. It means, "Yes, Father, I agree with everything you just prayed. I give you permission to pray it on my behalf." Your great Amen is very important. In the early church, they shouted it. Perfectly all right to sing it here. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Because we're about to pray a gospel prayer from the 6th chapter of Matthew, we all stand at the Savior's command and form by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. It is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Originally in the church, this gesture was called the kiss of peace. Perfectly all right to just shake hands. Let's offer one another a sign of God's peace. And the next gesture is one of the most important parts of the Mass. As we pray the Lamb of God, we rip the body of Jesus apart. We tear his body apart as his body was torn apart on the cross. This gesture, more than any other, says this is the sacrifice of the Mass, the sacrifice of Calvary. During the first 300 years of the church, the bishop was the only one who could celebrate Mass. At some point in those years of persecution and hiding, some bishop got sick or old during Mass. The priest would stand in a semicircle behind him. At some point, one of them said, "Father, come up here. Stand next to me and say the words for me. I'm too sick." And so he said the words to the bishop. The bishop said, "Well, that worked out fine. I'm just going to send one of you across town to say the words for me over there." And so that's how the priests were sent out to celebrate the Mass in place of the bishop. But they would get to a place in the Mass, they'd stop, wait, sing, pray, do what they had to do. At the bishop's Mass, after the consecration, the bishop would break off a piece of the body of Christ, hand it to the fastest runner, who would run across town, run into the other place, take it, and drop it on top of the pile of unconsecrated bread. The priest would then say, "Our yeast is here," and continue the Mass. We still call this part of the Mass the fermentum. And it symbolizes that if he could be, Bishop Johnson would be here celebrating this, but he can't be everywhere, so he sent me. That's what the symbol means. This is still the bishop's Mass. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy to shed under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Christ, the body of 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 Christ. I'm still watching you. The body of Christ.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all. Throughout
Let us pray. Accompany with constant protection, O Lord, those you renew with these heavenly gifts, and in your never-failing care for them, make them worthy of eternal redemption. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. I got this done in 57 minutes. I owe you no time back. I owe you nothing. I kept it under an hour. That's fine. I was watching the news this morning, and somebody was all upset. They're calling it the monkey pox. I guess it's upsetting the little dears. They're going to come up with another name for it. I had no idea monkeys had such tender feelings. I remember when we used to get the swine flu. Oh, they were up in arms. We can't call it the swine flu. I guess the little fellows that get their quiggly tails all straightened out. So they change it to the H1N1. Well, you write out H1N1, it looks like Heine. So now it's the Heine flu. I never had Heine flu. I never even had any swine flu. But you got to be careful nowadays, because they come after you if you use the wrong word. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Go in peace. Thanks be to God.